Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the third session of the Symposium of Handel Laureates. You are lucky to be in this room because the Langmuir lectures, which come towards the end of this morning, are also held in this room. It isn't very large, you might as well hold on to your seats. It's a heavy place to be. Our first lecture today will be by Professor Gabor Samardzai of the University of California at Berkeley. The Scandal Award was in 1981, and the title of his lecture at that time was The Structure and Selective Catalysis of Hydrocarbons on Platinum Crystal Surfaces. Today he has a long title. I am going to run into his lecture time when I read it. The Dynamical Restructuring of Surfaces, period. A new model for forming the surface chemical bond and for heterogeneous catalysis.
Thank you very much. Well, the colloid and surface science division is a great division, and I had the good fortune to serve it for a few years as one of its officers. It's absolutely delightful to see how it flourishes. And the secret, I believe, is that one ought to make everybody comfortable under one umbrella. And there are clubs of many types, and those clubs are most valuable. But when they are all put in under one umbrella, then they interact. And of course, you see the outcome in a very hardworking, productive, and creative community within the division. Now, those who get awards, like the Kendall Award, in one way or another, put their stamp on their discipline. This stamp is often noticeable in the long run. And what I'd like to tell you in the beginning is how I do surface science. And what is what I see is my particular contribution to this. The other thing, and this is the most challenging one, is that as we age, as time goes on, we have to keep up with the field. We have to develop. The field moves. It moves away from us. And we simply just cannot sit on our laurels, but we have to somehow not only participate in the development, but perhaps do more than that. Okay? And I'd like to show, as I progress, you know, how the field, as I see, develops in this decade and perhaps the next one. May I have you turn on the projector up there on the other side? Just put on the power, please. Now, I'm going to just try to use slides to put you through this. The way I usually do science is try to understand surfaces on a molecular level, but then try to make a major attempt to relate it to macroscopic properties. And in my case, these are chemical and usually catalytically oriented, or recently mechanical, because mechanical properties like chemical properties mean bond breaking, local properties, unlike electronic or magnetic properties, which are transport. In this case, we talk about local bond breaking, and I'm comfortable with that. So we go from molecular to macroscopic. And usually I use single crystals and small area crystal surfaces. We carry out both static measurement and dynamic. And this is also important, because there was a time, certainly in the 60s in chemistry, where it was conveniently broken up to people who do static measurements, like diffraction, for example, or similar, and dynamics, on the other hand. And of course, life is just not that simple. And then we use a large variety of techniques that are ultra-high vacuum compatible, because that I use to clean surfaces. And of course, the surfaces I use are sort of small, 1 square centimeter, small area surfaces, very different from the high microporous, hundreds of square meter per gram surfaces that are so important also in surface and colloid chemistry. in these days we increase complexity. So we grow oxides on substrates of single crystals layer by layer, sort of layer growth epitaxy. The beauty of this is that complex materials can be prepared with well-defined stoichiometry and structure this way, and you really work with 10 layers or so to mimic the properties of an oxide phase without worrying about bulk impurities. Now, then we put our sample so prepared and characterized into high pressures. In these days, we go to a liquid phase. Not only high pressure gases, but liquid, we can do things at the solid-liquid interface, for example, liquid phase hydrogenation on these little platinum surfaces. Now, let me tell you the rest in terms of how I see the field developing. I think we are going through as a continuous revolution in surface science. And this may be expressed by how we view the surface model-wise. In the 2030s, we had a smooth surface model. And then, around the 50s, we went into a rigid, a rock surface model. And what I'm going to show you, and the challenge is now that we really start to understand complex surface phenomena by looking at surfaces that are flexible. The surface is not rigid, but it is flexible. And this change it has a profound effect on the way we view surfaces. Let me just briefly go through. I'm sure you remember in the 30s or earlier, the rise of electrochemistry, colloid chemistry, and surface physics. The model that was developed, the surface space charge model, the surface was smooth, the electrons were spilling out and creating a space charge. And this space charge affected, of course, the Helmholtz layer, the work function of surfaces. The adsorbate has different work functions. And this smooth surface model explained a lot. In fact, in colloid chemistry, we are still using it. As far as I can see, the structure of the colloid is still one of a smooth surface where the charge certainly dominates. But I think the modern techniques can really look at the structure of colloids as a solid-liquid interface on an atomic scale. And I'm sure in the next, I would say, 5 to 10 years, there will be a lot of studies to determine molecular structure at these colloid interfaces. Now, then came the 50s, and in the 50s, there were electron microscopy and other techniques that revealed roughness. And there were lots of sites. And this was a great model. The problem is that each atom was expected to sit in its equilibrium position dominated by the bulk bonding. So if you knew the bulk structure, you could determine where the surface atoms are sitting. And that is why I call this a rigid lattice, rough lattice model. And it was great, and in fact, this is a scanning tunneling microscope picture, one of our recent toys. And this shows steps and kinks beautifully on various spatial resolution scale down to atomic resolution. So these atomic steps and kinks are really there. Now, these gave rise to these models of steps and kinks, and if you see my book published about 10 years ago, it's full of these things. Now, I can tell you now that these pictures are really incorrect. They are wrong, and in fact they hide a lot of surface chemistry that we cannot explain by just these simple models like that, but they were very useful to us. Now, what has been developing is that the surfaces are not like the bulk, they restructure. And this is, I just show one example, this is an iridium 110 phase, top layer atom, second layer, third layer, and atoms are missing. It's called the missing row model in the restructured surface. Besides, the top layer of atoms go downward, the second layer goes sideways, and the third layer goes downward again. So the bulk-like equilibrium position just simply doesn't sustain at the surface. In fact, the steps that we were, you know, if you see my book, it's full of these steps, rigid. This is how they look like in my book. The way they really look like is this. The atom at the corner sinks deeper, there's a little cluster forming, there's a crevice here. So this step structure, this rock slide, is very complicated. It undergoes restructuring, relaxation, and of course there are thermodynamic reasons for it. The surface doesn't like these sudden changes. It wants to smooth out the surface, you see? But the surface is restructured. It is dynamic. And what we have been learning is that the rougher the surface, the more it relaxes, the more it restructures. You shouldn't look at the surface as rigid, you should look at it as flexible. As flexible, the rougher it is, the more the atoms move away from their bulk-like equilibrium position. This is the one that shows it. This is due to Marcus and Jonah. If you look at this relaxation invert, the minus sign means invert, as a function of roughness, the roughness is designed as 1/1 the packing density. So the more open the surface, the rougher it is, the larger the relaxation. So the atoms relax inward, they move inward, the more open the surface. So the surface is not rigid. Now, once you accept that the surface is not rigid, you can start seeing very interesting phenomena. The surface shows up its richness. First of all, adsorbates, that chemisorbon surfaces, cause the surface to totally restructure. And one example is you put sulfur on iron. This is the iron 110 surface, bulk-like unit cell. You put a sulfur, the sulfur forms a fourfold site. It pulls the iron atoms into symmetrical position to make a sort of iron 4 sulfur cluster. Of course, as a result, the spacing between next nearest neighbor iron atoms is increasing. You basically form Fe4S clusters on the surface. Now you remove the sulfur, you go back here. So the surface on a micro scale is totally restructured in the act of chemisorption. And obvious, the reason is obvious, you form metal sulfur bond, which are just as strong as the metal-metal bond, so the formation of this bond is paying for the weakening of that bond. Now here is another example, this is a nickel 100 phase, you see? Now you put a carbon atom in there, in a fourfold site, the carbon sinks deep, but it can only do that by moving the nickel out, make the big, the unit cell a little bit bigger, and so this way the carbon can make bonds to the second layer of nickel as well. But of course this puts a tremendous compression of the nearest neighbor nickels, so as a result the unit cell rotates with respect to this unit cell, rotates this way, that way, this way, that way, and this way you avoid the stress. And so, look, a half a monolayer of carbon, by maximizing its bonding to the first and second layer, totally restructures the surface. So the surface is dynamic within the time scale of chemisorption. Then there are other studies that show that the surface is dynamic on the time scale of catalytic reaction. If you look at CO oxidation, and this was studied by Professor Oertel and others in the Fries Haber Institute and us, you find that this is one of those interesting oscillatory reactions. The reaction goes through sort of periodic oscillations leading to temperature, periodic temperature excursions like that. And there are many reasons for this, I don't want to belabor, but one of them is the surface gets oxidized and reduced. And it has actually two branches, one run on the metallic surface, one run on the oxidized surface. There are many other changes that occur, restructuring, for example, but clearly the formation of a metastable oxide like platinum oxide and its reduction is a structural change. So the structural change induces the chemistry, or the chemistry induces the structural change, either way. This is a longer range structural change. When you put alumina promoter on iron in ammonia synthetic catalysts, the alumina forms iron aluminate, which in fact, under the reaction conditions, re-precipitates iron by as an iron 111 single crystallite. Now, iron 111 is the most active crystal phase of iron for this catalytic reaction. So you can take any iron surface and recrystallize it to the 111 orientation. And the iron aluminate phase is the catalyst to grow this epitaxial iron 111 film. Now this type of rearrangement involves mass transport. So the reaction, the restructuring is long range. So you have restructuring of surfaces in the time scale of chemisorption, in the time scale of a catalytic reaction, and on much longer time scale, leading to deactivation or activation. So whatever we do in surfaces, It is always restructuring, it's dynamic, it's flexible. Now, so this is the message that I think is giving rise to what the view we look at surfaces in these days. We restructure and we do chemistry that way. Now, so I'm going to show you some complex phenomena to show you how we explain that only by restructuring. Epitaxy is one. Now, epitaxy is a marvelous business. Those of you who are not in this field, and I'm certainly not in there, you find the following. All the devices in microelectronics are grown by taking a substrate like gallium arsenide and growing gallium phosphide, a heteroepitaxy layer on it, of 100 angstrom or 1,000 angstrom thickness. Now, the gallium arsenide restructures, like most semiconductor surfaces. Nevertheless, you grow on top of it gallium phosphide, which matches all the lattice parameters beautifully. Now, how can you do that? It's a metastable situation. Well, the way you do it is that both sides of the interface sort of flexible and restructure to create maximum bonding, optimum bonding, you see? Now, so far, on a rigid lattice model, we couldn't understand that. That very unlike materials with different lattice parameters form beautiful epitaxy. Well, the surface obliges. It restructures because it's flexible. A simple example to show you that, if you take platinum, which is face-centered cubic, rhenium, which is hexagonal closed band, you vaporize rhenium on platinum, the rhenium grows as FCC, face-centered cubic. Now you reverse it. You put platinum on rhenium, the platinum becomes hexagonal closed band for about 10 atomic layers. Then it goes back through some defect structure into its bulk-like structure. So you can maintain metastable phases. How do you explain that? Well, because the surface is flexible. It obliges to your requirements of bonding. The other one is the real mystery that I spend a lot of my career on, is why is it that rock surfaces do chemistry? Now, it is not an accident that when physicists do sort of devices to make electronic gadgets, semiconductor devices, they want to avoid roughness. They don't want chemistry. So they work on the smoothest, flattest, atomically flattest surfaces possible, and they are right. Because when we do roughness, that's when we do chemistry. But of course, you and I make a living on that. And so we want rough surfaces. Now, just to demonstrate that to you, if you take a flat platinum surface, a stepped one, and a kinked one, you absorb hydrogen. On the flat surface, it comes off, this is temperature program desorption, comes off at a much lower temperature, a lower temperature than on a stepped surface, and on a kinked surface, it comes off in a higher temperature mode as well. And that means the hydrogen is at a step, teres, kink, step, teres. And the defect always holds a hydrogen with a higher binding energy because hydrogen comes off at a higher temperature. So the binding energy, the thermodynamics of adsorption, is very much affected by the defects. But so is catalysis. If you look at now a transport, a catalytic reaction like that, you find that in fact, when you do H2D2 exchange, the same surfaces, on a step surface, the H2D2 exchange has almost a unit reaction probability. On a defect-free platinum 111 phase, it is down by three orders of magnitude. It's below the detection limit. Namely, the reaction does not occur on this surface, but it occurs with unit probability on a step surface. So rough surfaces are good for you, whether you want to do catalysis or whether you want to do bond breaking in a thermodynamic sense. Now, how do you explain that? Well, you explain it with great difficulty based on a rigid lattice model. Because in fact, here there is a major contradiction. You cannot possibly have strong bonding at a site where also you have great catalysis. Catalysis means turnover. See? Strong bonding means long residence time. You're blocking that site. Yet, both happening. You cannot explain it on a rigid lattice model. All you can do is, on a flexible model, is that, well, the strongly adsorbed hydrogen restructures the surface and creates the active site. And so the active site is created by the restructuring of the process. Okay, another very interesting thing we live with, very complex phenomenon, is thermal activation. we take a molecule like ethylene, we absorb it at low temperature, it is gas phase-like, we heat it up to room temperature, it loses the hydrogen, it becomes different, and then 100 degrees later, it breaks a few bonds, it becomes different again. We can understand how the molecule structure after it changed. What we don't understand, why does it change at a given temperature, at a given, on a given surface, and why does it go through these sequential changes? Well, I'd like to propose that the reason is that there are phase transformations. There are restructuring. The surface undergoes restructuring that induces bond breaking to go from here to there and there, and that depends on a given molecule and on a given surface. What we need to do is just prove that, and that's not that easy, because what we need are dynamical surface measurements that can occur on a time scale shorter than, let's say, this sort of dynamic of change. In these days, though, you can do femtosecond laser chemistry, and there's a good chance that, in fact, one can follow the dynamics of this restructuring. But, of course, the origin of that was a physisorption-chemisorption transition of dinitrogen, which occurs at 155 Kelvin on an iron surface, not 150, not 160, 155. Just to show you that these restructuring on a step surface occurs at a much lower temperature than on a flat surface. So rough surfaces do the same chemistry, but at a much lower temperature. So the final point is that we have some unique catalysts that we build by using bimetallic systems or metal oxide interfaces. And we cannot understand them unless we invoke restructuring. Okay? And the typical observation, you put a little bit of a monolayer of rhenium on platinum, suddenly for this reaction, the catalyst becomes about an order of magnitude better. Better than pure rhenium, pure platinum, and it becomes better. What is even curious, more curious, that it doesn't matter whether you put rhenium on platinum or you put platinum on rhenium, you get the same effect. The same effect. So the interface is uniquely catalytically active. Why? Well, I propose that because it restructures. You roughen up the surface. By alloying it, you make it rougher. And that dynamics is what runs the catalytic reaction. This is an example from Boudard. He put gold into palladium for the H2O2 reaction, and he got a 50-fold increase in catalytic activity by putting a very inert metal into a palladium, and that you cannot understand unless you invoke some uniqueness. And the uniqueness, I think, is gold is sort of helps to roughen up the surface, to restructure it in a dynamic sense. And the final point is oxide metal interfaces. In these days, of course, most catalysts are oxide metal interfaces. We use more and more to make unique catalysts. And there is one type, and this is the so-called strong metal support interaction type, where the way you make the catalyst is you heat it in such a way as to put the oxide on top of the metal, and then by a heat treatment in oxygen to make little oxide islands on top of the metal to maximize the oxide metal interface area. And the reason is that the catalyst works at that interface. And we can do that on a single crystal, we can vaporize the oxide, and what you find here is that for CO2 hydrogenation, for example, the metal is good, not too good, but good. The titanium oxide is almost zero, but the sort of half a monolayer of titanium oxide on the metal makes a superb catalyst. And the active sites are at the interface. So the oxide-metal interfaces and metal-metal interfaces have unique properties. And again, I would suggest the reason is dynamics. That is a restructuring, and that dynamics runs the catalytic turnover. Well, we can image these days with a scanning tunneling microscope the oxide islands, and I have a hope that within the next year or two, we can actually monitor the structural changes that occur at the titanium oxide-metal interface during the catalytic reaction, because you can use scanning tunneling microscopy under atmospheric conditions as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Samardzai, for a tremendous amount of material in the
very short
sort of time that there is time for a amount of material in the
very short
sort of time that there is time for about one question. Quick one.
Well, I'd just like to make a comment, and that is that I think the term dynamics is wrong. I think it's the drive towards equilibrium that counts. Because if you look at it from the general point of view, this is no different than, let's say, a liquid vapor interface or a liquid liquid interface, which is trying to develop, you know, a non-sharp singlet density distribution function to the liquid. And in the solid, you have all these constraints, so it's harder to get there. And there are two kinds of things that happen. One is the kind of things that happen in thermal etching, where you can't transport large amounts of material, but the surfaces which are exposed in the
liquid surface.
Okay, fine. I'll stop. Okay.
I'm not sure I understand your comment. The thermodynamic is wrong in what sense? We create lots of so-called metastable structures and surfaces,
yeah.
Heteroepitaxy, oxide metal interfaces, things like that, and they seem to live for a long time. And I'm giving an argument for why they do so.
Yeah, it's just that the driving force,
yeah.
the drive to reach an equilibrium distribution. So it's non-equilibrium. That's the problem. A non-equilibrium system, and the system wants to reach equilibrium. Entropy becomes important at higher temperatures.
Totally agree, but we freeze in a situation where the change may take a couple of years.
Right.
You see, so we can maintain a metastable high surface area system like a catalyst, alive for a long time because, you know, the move to equilibrium is slow.
I'm just thinking of drive.
May I continue this further?